Good morning, y'all. Great to have y'all. Yay. We got a crowd for COVID-19, you know. We 6 months ago, we'd have been disappointed with this meeting, but it's like, yay. We're coming back. Yay. Let's see here. Always forget to do this. Yeah, it's blessed to be here with y'all today. We welcome you to First United Methodist Church of Garrison, Texas. We welcome you that are watching online. All of you, welcome. We're glad that you're here. Pray God's blessings on you and that you move a little bit closer maybe to the Lord or back to the Lord or whatever through this experience today. We don't have a whole lot of things going on right now, due mainly to COVID-19 and what have you. And so if anybody's got anything they wanted to mention, anything about the school starts or anything that's still on track, or y'all got, it may be too early to say anything, and I don't want to put you on the spot. It's okay. So school will maybe start here in about 5 or 6 weeks. We'll see. Maybe some hybrid stuff going on. I don't know just exactly. Yeah, I think the school system is still kind of working on what that needs to look like, and I don't know. So y'all say a little prayer for them as they try to figure out what's the best thing and the safe thing going forward. I know it's got to be kind of mind numbing to try and figure out, to be honest with you. So we're meeting basically on Sundays right now. We have an online Bible study, but it's about to wrap up. And anyway, maybe we'll do something else online if anybody's interested in that. I'll let you know here in a couple of weeks about the possibility of a new Bible study. Any other announcements that need to be made today? I can't really think of anything. Okay.
Food pantry is the 22nd, so it's not this week.
Thank you. Yes, that kind of has a way of being out of sight and out of mind right now. So thank you. And of course, y'all know that our food pantry person that's kind of been in director of it, I guess you'd say, and ordered for us, and has been here on Wednesdays to take names down of our clients that show up.
Yes, we do that this time.
Okay, so you're going to take over that. I think Rusty, she helped Rusty to make the order, so the order's been done. Rusty's shaking his head back there.
She did help. It's done.
Everybody may get a bunch of mayo or something like that. But
it,
Well, anyway, there's an order that's been placed, and good Lord willing, next Monday they'll go pick it up, and on the following Wednesday we'll hand it out.
By the way, we've been ordering from 11 years and 2 months. We've distributed 480,000 pounds of groceries. Almost
$180,000 of groceries through this food pantry in 11 years, and spent like what, $50,000, something like that.
$40 something.
It's
up there close.
And we did it for a couple months before
fire sale. No, you did, because y'all were doing it by yourselves.
Well,
I got
six months.
Yeah, y'all were doing it by yourselves. Had been. And we got a guy from North Street Church of Christ to come over here and talk to us about using the food bank in Tyler.
Well, they might just do it 6 months before they would take us.
Yeah. So.
The food bank Tyler.
Yeah. So there you go.
We
had
to prove ourselves.
So y'all have done it. Y'all, with the good Lord's help, and thank God. All right, so let's see. I think we got prayer concerns next. My technology is woefully inadequate. So anyway, we're going to try and y'all bear with me today. Since we don't have any musicians now, they're down. So we're going to try and, you know, stagger through this with some recorded music. So hopefully that'll do okay. Okay, so prayer concerns. I know Lillian and Jimmy. Who else we got besides Lillian and Jimmy?
The Furness family.
Yeah, I heard about Dr. Ed passed away.
And the Bell family.
Yeah, how's Robert?
Chandler's uncle passed away.
Who's that?
Chandler's uncle.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I thought you were thinking about Robert Bell. Okay. Bell family. And then there is Robert.
Jeanette Garrison family.
Jeanette Garrison family.
Mel's son passed away yesterday.
Melvis?
His son,
Brooks.
Brooks
Bell family.
Is that the same one we're talking about? Oh, okay. Okay. Okay.
Patricia Jackson.
Okay.
Did you mention it last time, you know, Walt Roberts?
We did last time, but it's okay because I'm in my...
I talked with her Friday and Barbara, and she said that, you know, Walt enjoyed this church, the preaching and the people and the fellowship more than any other church that he's
been to. I can see that.
Pastor Walt Roberts.
Thanks for sharing that. We got Catherine Cruz and Sybil Elliott. Sybil Elliott turned 95 this week. I saw it on Facebook. Jeff posted that.
Her birthday.
Remember, she had her 90th over here. I guess it would have been 5 years ago. So, any others we're forgetting about? Doug Schumick. Any praises? Okay.
We moved Caitlin into her apartment in Galveston, and she starts school tomorrow.
So Caitlin is moved into Galveston and starts school tomorrow. Wow. Okay.
They had meetings this last week, but they actually start class tomorrow.
Well, awesome.
She took her white out last week.
Well, that's awesome. Congratulations. That's a blessing, man.
And I have one. My niece has a new grandson born July 2nd. So
okay.
We have a new family member.
Well, look
I
at
have
that.
A great nephew.
Well, all right. Yay. That is awesome. Good deal. All right. Any other any praises? Any more praises? Oh, I hate to cut the praises off. That's good. Okay. Let's see, what have I got? Oh, went the wrong way. All right, so here's some recording real quick. So let's see how this works. Thank you.
inside you. Covered by your love, covered by your blood, covered by your righteousness. Covered by your love, covered by your blood, covered by your righteousness.
So let's pray. Let's hope the TV stays on. It's going to stay on. Okay. Holy God, we come before you today. We thank you and praise you for being our God, for loving us, for sending your Son into this world to pay the price for our sins that we might be made right with you. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving us, for living in our hearts by the power of your Holy Spirit, be our comforter and our guide, and Lord, giving us the hope of life eternal with you. Thank you, Lord, for that. We pray that you would continue to bless us and use us for your glory in a way that's pleasing to you. Lord, we lift up the folks that are on our hearts and minds today. We pray for them and for these families that are grieving. Lord, we pray for healing for those that are sick or hurting, recovering from bone breaks and such, Lord. We just pray that you would pour out your healing upon them, give comfort and peace to those who mourn, Lord, that you would be there in their midst, that they would reach out to you and you would bring them what they need to bless them and move them forward in a way that's pleasing to you. Thank you that you're a loving God who wants to help us. And we just praise you. Lord, we continue to pray for President Trump and all of our elected and appointed officials that govern in this land. We pray that you would use them to guide our nation in the direction that you would have for it to go. We do pray for an end to the division in our government and in our nation. We pray for an end to racial discrimination. We pray that that would end, Lord. We pray, we do pray for our police force and Lord, that we pray that they would rule and govern and police in a way that is pleasing to you and not according to prejudice and bias. Lord, we pray that you would continue to work here to bring revival. We pray that out of this COVID-19, there would be a great hunger for you that would happen as a result, and that there would be a great revival when everything's lifted, Lord, that there would be people seeking you, and that they would do it even now, that they would find you online or wherever that they could find you in many places right now. I pray that they would do that, and they would meet you, and you would save them, and they would live their lives to please you, Lord. That would be a blessing if that could come out of this, a great turning back to you. Lord, we continue to pray that you would help us to be your church here in Garrison and wherever you might send us. Help us to represent you in a way that is pleasing to you. And we pray that we would follow in the footsteps of your son, Jesus, who taught us how to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Okay, so we have a Psalter. I'll read the odd verses, 1 and 3 and on. If y'all will help read the even verses, how about that? To you I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. Let none that wait for you be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are clothed with treachery. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore the Lord instructs sinners in the way and leads the humble in what is right, teaches them their way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep the Lord's covenant and testimonies. Let's see. All right, let's try this one. Well, I guess that was it. That's the thing about technology. Sometimes it works, and sometimes it don't. But y'all got the idea, right? Anyway, interesting. So the Apostles' Creed. We haven't done Apostles' Creed lately. So if you would you mind standing and let's affirm our faith in the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And what we say on our lips, may we believe in our hearts. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Please be seated. All right, so let's pray with me, if you would. Lord, I pray that the words that I speak and the meditations in each of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, that it would bring you glory, honor, and majesty through your Son, Jesus. You would be glorified. Amen. All right. So here is the scripture reading for today. If you're familiar with the 8th chapter of Romans, this is the first 11 verses. Some of the most well-read passages in all of Scripture. So we'll begin with verse 1, chapter 8. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. This is Romans 8, 1 through 11. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. All right. Okay. So I wanted to kind of start with this little analogy. If you're carrying a bucket of water that's full to the brim, and you're going to carry it from here to, you know, say, down the stairs at the church and out to the street, what's the best way to do that? Do you look where you're going, or do you look at the bucket of water? If you've ever carried a bucket of water like that, or a bowl of water, or something like that, just my experience, you don't look at the bowl of water. That's the wrong thing to do. You look where you're going. You keep your eyes focused on that. And you know what? Something amazing happens. You may swash a little bit of water out, but it won't be too bad. It won't be as bad as if you're trying to watch that water as you're taking little duck steps. So just keep that in the back of your mind as we go forward here. So set free. I wanted to talk to you about set free. Now I'm going to start with a kind of a provocative story, and I realize it's controversial. Maybe it's. It's disturbing to me, and I suspect it may be disturbing to you in multiple ways. And I confess to you up front that I'm still bothered by this 17 years later, and I haven't fully reconciled it either. It comes with a disclaimer on the front end, okay? So here's what happened. 17 years ago, living in the parsonage in Corrigan, Texas, First Methodist Church, Corrigan. My wife Judy was the pastor there, had been living there for a couple of years. She invited this African-American pastor, kind of famous African-American pastor, I say, in the Texas Annual Conference. Great guy. Invited him to come and preach a revival in Corinth. And he graciously accepted. We were kind of flabbergasted that he would even take time out of his busy schedule to come and preach. But he did. And he came for, maybe it was 3 nights, I forget exactly now. It's been 17 years ago. But he came and did an awesome job. And everybody was enthralled with him and his preaching. And we had asked him to come and let us take him out to dinner, you know, every night. But he was unable to do that until, I believe, the last night that he came. We went out to dinner, had an amazing time, a great dinner. We're pulling back in at the parsonage, and it had a carport, okay? Two-bay carport. I think one of our vehicles was parked in the left-hand side, and we were in my wife's Suburban, which was our nicer car. we had a nice car and then a junker that I drove around. So, I was pulling in and we were laughing and having a great time, and something happened. I mean, just, I noticed that he looked, as I was pulling in the carport, and noticed that the garbage can was right there. And y'all, it was as if I had struck him. Somehow in his journey of life, he had come to expect racial discrimination against him, you know, offenses to be committed. Now, I put this forward, he was raised in the 50s and early 60s primarily. So he saw a different part of the world than I did, although I saw some of that same stuff. And Lord knows, I don't know his journey, you know, I don't. And I submit that to y'all. But it was as if I had struck him. His countenance changed like that. And his face dropped as I saw him look at the garbage can and then look back. I was thinking, oh my God, you know, I wouldn't have offended this man. I mean, this is where we always pulled up, right? I mean, when my wife's sitting there in the car, that's where she got out, was right by, you know, the garbage can. Didn't think anything about it. And I'm thinking, Lord, have mercy, what can I do? You know, so I jumped out of the truck, ran around, and was trying to move the garbage can a little further away as he was getting out of the truck, but it was too late. I mean, it was done. So that was it. He put himself back together. I mean, he went on as if nothing had happened. Priest, another amazing sermon. I mean, I've seen him many times since then, and he's pretending like nothing happened, but I saw what I saw, and we both know. And I don't know. So, there's a lot going around right now about this, right? I understand that our nation's kind of on edge about this right now, and I submit to you that I don't have an answer to that I don't know, but I know that there's a segment of our population that is walking around that they've been through a different journey than pretty much we have, right? I mean, they've experienced life, and I don't know what the answer is to that, okay? I tell you that up front. I don't know. So, okay, let me continue with where I was going on this. So I got more questions than answers. If you look at the passage of Scripture today, through Christ we're set free from all of our sins and brokenness, okay? If we're in Christ, we're set free. The honest God truth is, and y'all probably heard this a million times, But because of our sinful condition, we're condemned to spend an eternity separated from God. Sin is the great transgressor in us. It keeps us from communicating with God. There's this great chasm between us and God because God is holy, holy, holy. He's all good, all merciful, all gracious, all loving, all kind. Not a sinner. He doesn't sin. And then there's us, right? And we've all broken God's law. We've all messed up. We've all been looking at the water when we should have had our eyes focused on Christ. We've been looking at the law instead of all. We can't. The Jews couldn't follow the law either. It took Christ coming. So sin keeps us from drawing near to God. It's this chasm that can't be breached by anything that we try to do, any good deed that we do, any organization we belong to, what have you. There's only one way. And that took this loving and merciful God sending his only Son into this world. And contrary to what some popular media hosts may suggest, he lived a sinless life. He did not sin. He lived a perfect life. He pleased God with every breath that he took. And he lived to show us the way to honor God. And he was crucified because of that. He took our sins, mine and yours, and the whole world's sins onto himself and crucified it on a cross that we might be forgiven, that we may be made right with God. He did it once for all sins, for all people, for all time, regardless of skin color or language we speak or ethnicity. He did it once for all. Now, our first passage in today's scripture says, there's therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. So, I submit to you that I've done the best I know how in the living of my life to live by the golden rule, right? To treat others the way I would want to be treated, regardless of skin color, regardless of language they spoke or ethnicity and all that stuff. I submit that to you. I've tried to live transparent before the living God. If he's had something wrong with me, I pray that he's fixed it and he's tried to work to fix it. So, can I fix my black friend and the journey he's been on? I can't fix it, okay? From what psychologists and counselors tell me, you can't fix somebody else, right? You know, you can't fix what's wrong, broke with them. All I can do is to fix, work with God's help to fix me, right? I mean, that's what they tell you. Anything else, you're trying to do something you it's not in your power to do. Can I try to help bring racial healing in this country and in this community? Yeah, I can help try to do that. I think so. What's wrong with that? Can I reach out to others regardless of race or ethnicity? Yes. Should I? Let me dangle this out in front of you. Should I feel guilty for having not done enough? I don't think so. If you look at this passage, therefore, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, right? If I'm following God, is that going to please everybody? Did Jesus please everybody in the living of his life? Let me just back up and ask that question. The short answer is no, he didn't. He didn't please the scribes and the Pharisees. He didn't please the zealots who wanted him to overthrow the Roman government and, you know, set up David's throne again. So if Jesus didn't please everybody, you know, I got to think, we're probably not going to either. And the other thing is, we're not judged by the world, we're judged by Christ. So just hang on to that for a minute. Oh my goodness. My TV died. All right. So set your mind on Christ. So we've got two boys that are in college. One of them's doing really well. The other one, he's kind of got his priorities out of whack, right? We kind of were half expecting that. And sure enough, it's, you know, we haven't been disappointed. He'd rather have fun than, you know, than to actually do schoolwork. It just provides him an opportunity to be hanging out with his buds all the time and, you know, what have you. So we're hoping and praying that you know, he gets a new priority, you know, and that he gets a new focus and changes some of that. So in our spiritual lives, what this passage says, for those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. So, you know, early on in our Christian journey, it's common for us to struggle with setting our mind on Christ. We've lived our whole lives trying to please ourselves and our own wants and desires and all. We need guidance and help in making that transformation. And guess what? The Spirit of God is helpful in that process. The Old Testament prophet Ezekiel tells us what God says about those of us living after Christ who put our faith in Christ. Here it is. That's in Ezekiel 36, 26 and 27. And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. The convicting power of God goes a long way to help us to reorient our world. We transition from a viewpoint of ourselves at the center of our universe to God being at the center of our universe. He sits on the throne and not us. Our world begins to revolve around pleasing God with the guidance of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit will not only correct us, but he opens doors for us and encourages us. He leads and guides us. Do any of us get it perfect? Not me. Heck no. I make mistakes every day. It's a constant learning experience for us. We learn and grow in our understanding, in our love for God, and in our love for neighbor. God's word is instructive here as well. As the Spirit takes God's word and amplifies it to our hearts and minds so that it takes root in us and grows and helps transform us. We need the church and Christian friends to study and grow with in Christ. We're under construction and we need to stay plugged into the faith in order to grow. The good news is that when we mess up, God's there to help and encourage us to go forward, to get back up and go on. Many of y'all know that I'm in my third marriage, right? So one of my marriages failed. Okay, the other one was my wife was deceased, okay? So I can't really take blame for that. But I will say that having God at the center of your family makes all the difference in the world. It would have made a difference in my first, but we weren't there. So it fell apart. Should we look to the popular culture for our answers? I don't think so. Many of the folks trying to lead popular culture right now are godless. They have no sense of God, no Christian values. And some of them may be trying to put us on a guilt trip for what we have or haven't done, right? And should we allow other people to put their litmus test of righteousness on us? I'm not going to let them put it on me. I'll just say that. I live before God, okay? I live before an audience of one. He is my judge. nobody else. Does that make any sense? I mean, I may not please everybody, and I'm okay with that. But I'm going to do my best to live before God. Okay, set on fire. Wesley said this, give me 100 preachers who fear nothing but sin and desire nothing but God, and I care not whether they be clergymen or laymen. They alone will shake the gates of hell and set up the kingdom of heaven upon the earth. I just something I don't dwell on very often, but since we're talking about the Holy Spirit in this passage, I'll mention to y'all that there seems to be an aversion to the Holy Spirit within the mainline church. It almost seems like we're afraid that we're going to go into convulsions, that we're going to do cartwheels down the center aisle and speak uncontrollably in tongues and just, you know, basically embarrass ourselves if we let the Holy Spirit, you know, into our life. That's not been my experience. My experience is the Holy Spirit is a perfect gentleman. He's your helper. He's your booster shot to get through this world. He's your down payment on eternal life. He's the very presence of Almighty God that works within us. If you're struggling with some kind of sinful behavior, the Spirit of God can help you to root it out. If you're feeling empty and abandoned, the Holy Spirit can fill you to the brim. If you're needing a hand to hold on to, the Holy Spirit will be your comforter. If you're not sure the direction to go, the Holy Spirit will help to guide you. So it begs a question, have you yielded your life to the work of the Holy Spirit? Have you invited the Holy Spirit to move and work in your life? Don't be afraid of him. I just suggest that you go somewhere this afternoon and get by yourself and just say, come Holy Spirit, have your way with me. That's simple. Just open your heart and life to the work of the Holy Spirit. You may be amazed what happens in the days and weeks and months ahead. Because if you let the Holy Spirit come in and have dominion, he's going to start bearing fruit. And he knows if he's wanted or not. He knows if we're afraid of him. And he's not going to bust the door down. I'm just saying. He's knocking on that door for us to let him in and let him work. Now, yeah, we believe that we get the Holy Spirit in our baptism, right? That's kind of a general belief of the Methodist Church. But there's more to it than that. That's not the end of it. Yeah, you got the Holy Spirit. Are you going to open up and let him rule you in your life? Are you going to let him take dominion of? So those kinds of things. And I think that's one reason so many Christians struggle with sin in their life is they haven't allowed the Spirit to take his rightful place. Remember, there's three persons of the Trinity, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and they're equally God, okay? The Spirit brings life abundant that Jesus promised, victory over the flesh, and triumph in the power of the Spirit. This is what Paul said again to remind you, but if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So, back to me again. I try not to live to please others or even please myself as much as I can help. I try to please God. I believe that's what Jesus did when he was here. He lived to please God, and he showed us that way. And I'm not going to let anybody else put me on a guilt trip about their checkbox for what they think is righteous and what they think is holy. I do my best to please the Lord in the power and the illumination of the Holy Spirit. If I'm doing that, Christ is my judge, as he is yours and nobody else. 17 years later, after that event in Corrigan, I submit to you that I'll just show you my family. I mean, I have a wife who's Korean. I have a daughter that went to China to get. My family is biracial, okay? our churches, I submit to y'all that our churches are in ministry to multiple races and ethnicities. The Bonita School, the after-school care over there, it's got multiple races involved in it, and we don't differentiate between any of them. They support Love Inc. and the SFA Wesley Foundation that is, you know, helps diverse people. The Garrison Food Pantry. Wow, y'all. I mean, the majority of our clients are not Caucasian. And how long have y'all said we were doing this? 11 years y'all been doing this? We've only missed 1 month because of COVID-19. And y'all show up every month to reach out to these folks, to give them food, to help them some little bit in the living of their lives. I gotta think that's a good thing. I don't think that's racist at all. I think if anything, that's reaching out, trying to bring healing, racial healing to this community. I believe it. Our St. Stephen's ministry, I mean, I don't keep up with it, but I dare say most of our folks that we've helped there with that benevolence ministry are not Caucasian either. And we don't look down on them. We help them, and we try to help them get back on their feet. And I'm thankful that we have the opportunity. So, is that enough, y'all? Is that enough? Well, you know, there's always more work to be done. And there is, you know. Guess what? When Jesus died and was risen, there was more work to be done, right? He didn't finish it all. It was just beginning to reach the Gentiles. And it reached him, us, if you will, after his death and resurrection. So, is that enough? I'm going to let God decide that. If he wants us to do more or something different, I'm counting on him to show us the way forward. How about you? May our God give us the strength and the ability to continue to reach out to any and all people, that he may be glorified in all that we do. May we keep our eyes lifted high to the risen Christ and be quick to follow him as the Holy Spirit leads, so that we will accomplish that he's hoping for us to accomplish. And remember, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set us free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Amen. Uh-oh. Let's see. I got one more musical thing here. Let's see if it'll work. And it's not right? Go forth and follow Christ and live your life before him to please him. Amen. God bless y'all. Have a great week. Thank you for coming. Yay. Yeah. Tomatoes.